Hi, folks. Coming up on Inspired with Patrick L. Riley, a woman who inspired me many years before we all called her Aunt Viv, and she continues to inspire today. A Pulitzer Prize-winning poet who inspires me through his words on tradition, tropes, and triumph. Daphne Maxwell Reed, Jericho Brown, and more on Inspired with Patrick L. Riley.
Hi, I'm Jericho Brown, and I am inspired with Patrick L. Riley. The L is for Leroy.
The L is for legit.
Hi, I'm Daphne Maxwell Reed, and I am inspired with Patrick L. Riley. The L stands for lovingly.
Hi, folks. Welcome to episode one of Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. So good to be with each of you and for us to use this virtual space to be together and to inspire each other. For a little on me, the L is for Leroy, as in my maternal grandfather, Elder Leroy Bellinger. He was a preacher and a pastor and the father of my late great mom, Queen Elizabeth Bellinger, and her sister, Auntie Mary Lee. With each of these Inspired with Patrick L. Riley episodes, you can expect inspiration-packed interviews and a video testimonial or two at the end of the show with you, our viewers, getting in on the inspiration party to let us know the special folks in your life who inspire you or continue to inspire you, like this one from my nephew.
My uncle, Patrick Riley, inspires me for a number of reasons. One, he's my uncle. Two, he's exposed me to so many different things. I tell everybody the story about how I came to New York at 7 years old to visit him with my aunt and my grandfather. And I looked around and I said, I'm gonna live here one day. And here I am. He's a Morehouse man, so am I. He was there on my first tour at Morehouse, and I ended up going there, I graduated, and I moved to New York, and I fulfilled the dream that I set forth for myself, and it's just been an exciting journey. To know him is to love him, and he's inspired me for a number of reasons, but those are the main ones.
Okay, now you guys want to make me cry, but there's no time for that, because we always have a friend's check-in. And today's friend's check-in is a person who inspires me because she brings her award-winning inspiration to Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. Welcome, Erica Cobb.
Patrick, oh my gosh, I am wonderful. Thank you so much for having me on. You know, you call, I answer, so I am here for you, okay?
We could go on and on, but I have to let the folks in on you now. When I say award-winning, I'm not just throwing words out there. Let me make sure I get this right. You are the recipient of the 2020 Trailblazer Award for the Black Women in Media.
Oh my gosh. Well, first of all, it's right here. I keep it in Comeback Studios because I always have to look at it to make sure it's real. It was just such an honor, and to be a part of that group and to be recognized by your peers, it was just absolutely something that I didn't see coming, and it meant so much to me to be recognized in that way.
What do you describe Daily Blast Live as, and what's been going on the air inside these strange times, if you will?
Well, Daily Blast Live was really what I had put out into the universe. I knew that I eventually wanted to make the transition to television. And I always said, if I were to do television, it would be radio for TV. And that's how I describe Daily Blast Live. We're breaking and trending entertainment daytime talk show. But you can also catch us not only on broadcast, but also on digital. So we air live on Facebook, we air live on YouTube, and the audience can interact with us in real time.
Now, it's worth noting that you do, from time to time, go viral. And we're actually looking at footage from your natural hair care journey that went viral a couple of years ago. Can you talk about what that journey was? Because it not only meant so much to the viewers, to the World Wide Web, but it meant so much to women at large, not just in the TV business, but in business. Can you talk about that natural hair care journey as we look at you so beautiful and natural here tonight?
So when I did the natural hair journey, it was not perfect, but that's life. It's not perfect. And I had to learn my hair, and my hair had to learn me. And so over the past 2 years, that has really built a relationship, not only with my hair, but with myself. 1 year to the day last year, I was asked to speak at the Colorado State Capitol for the Crown Act and give my testimony. That was 1 year to the day of my natural hair on-air reveal.
You know, inspiration is imperfection. And I think through your sharing and vulnerability, you've been able to build community. A podcast, for example.
I do a clip, a takeaway for my audience, and then they can go to the podcast on all podcast platforms or my online home, comeback.tv, to talk to people who are either on their comeback, have had a comeback, or are giving people tools for how to make comebacks in different areas.
Well, Erica Cobb, we love you, and I consider myself so blessed to have you as our inaugural friend check-in on Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. You are truly an inspiration.
I appreciate you so much, so thank you.
Awesome. Hey folks, we will be back with more Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. You heard it here. The L is for legit. We'll be right back with Daphne Maxwell Reed. If a movie was made of your life, what genre would it be?
It would be, it would definitely be a traumatic comedy with a happy ending.
Who would play you?
Well, Gabrielle Union, of course.
I love it. Our first guest inspires me because her career has been filled with firsts, smack dab in the spotlight. Even her second sparkle and continue to inspire the world. And here she is. Folks, it's Miss Daphne Maxwell Reed. Welcome to Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. Your cup runneth over with questions about Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, so I will only ask you one, which is, I know so much of it was therapeutic for Will and Janet and maybe some of the other original cast members. That sort of cross to bear wasn't yours. Did it still on some level feel, I don't know, cathartic for you? Just the whole experience of kind of coming full circle with both Aunt Vivs, if you will?
I was delighted to finally meet her. And I was happy for the whole. It was a necessity that she be there to celebrate the 30 years of Fresh Prince because she started it. And I was happy for her and for Will.
So great to finally see both of you together. It really was a beautiful moment for those of us who, you know, we find our inspiration through pop culture. I wanted to have you here to be able to talk about the history-making moves that you have been making from the beginning. Talk about your upbringing in New York, in Manhattan.
So that's where I grew up. My entire 18 years of life were spent in the projects. But you were exposed to so many different cultures growing up in Manhattan. I had friends who were Jewish, who were Muslim, who were Catholic, who were all sorts of religions. I got to participate in some of their services. It was an experience unlike you get in a narrow community of one kind of person.
Northwestern University, 1967, they tell me you were the first Black homecoming queen at Northwestern University. How did it all come to be?
It was an annoyance for me. Now, this is a university of a population of about 5,000 people. And at that time, there were maybe 70 Black people in the whole university.
Wow.
I'm queen. The president has to hold a ring of roses around my head as the crown. And he looked at me and wanted to spit. He just said, I have to hold this here till they take pictures. And he turned and he walked away. The next day was the football game at school. Yeah. And my community, the 78 Black people, came to the game and rallied around me. And there also was the Jet magazine, the Amsterdam News, the Pittsburgh Courier. We had a lot of Black press there interviewing me. I had no idea that this is the first time this has ever happened. Okay. I just happened to be it.
From what I'm hearing, you were already modeling, because I know that the Eileen Ford agency picked you up. I know you were traveling back and forth between Northwestern and New York. Can you talk about how modeling came to be with you?
In 1967, I was featured in 17 Magazine's Real Girl issue, because I had graduated from Bronx Science as president of the class of 958 students, and I also was a National Merit Scholarship winner. So they featured me as a real girl in the January issue. Eileen saw that picture and asked me to register with her. I didn't know anything about modeling.
Well, hold one second. The Eileen Ford.
Eileen Ford. Yes.
Now you're name dropping.
I just happened to have the acquaintance.
I love
it. She asked me to register with her. So I was doing editorials for Mademoiselle and 17 and the Girl Scout magazine and all sorts of things. And that's flying back and forth from college to New York. At one time I put on a little red jacket and I sat there. I don't think the photographer took a whole roll of pictures. He just snap. She said, okay, you can go back to school now. I didn't think anything else about it. I thought it was another editorial, something about makeup, I don't know. And that October of 69, I walked past the newsstand and I said, that's me on the cover of Glamour magazine. And that happened to be the first African-American on the cover of Glamour magazine. Wow.
Here we go.
And I look the same, don't I?
And you look just the same. How did this version of being a first feel for you?
It was kind of catchy, I have to say.
And you jumped in the pond. How long did you model before you then transitioned into acting? And how long were you acting before you got your big break?
Through the early 70s, opportunities arose for me to try out for a commercial in Chicago. And I got a commercial. And they paid me a lot of money with it just running and running around. I said, oh, this could be a living. I could make a living doing this. And that's basically when I said, okay, I'll jump in this pond. And my big break came from Chicago. It was Robert Conrad who had come to town to shoot a television series called The Duke. And I auditioned and I got the part. And I worked with him on about 6 or 7 episodes. So that was my break into the television format. And a couple of years later, I moved out to California and I called Robert Conrad, say, how you doing? It's your Queenie. That's what he used to call me. And he said, oh, I have another role for you on A Man Called Sloan for next week. Here's somebody, check him out as an agent. I got an agent right when I landed in Los Angeles. So I started working. I happened to be in Los Angeles at an opportune time that they were looking for Black people to be in episodic television. And I was in the right place at the right time. I had the right connections, and I had the chops to perform.
Daphne Maxwell Reed is creating herself. You have beautiful clothing line, brocade jackets. There's a cookbook. Can you just talk about all that you are enterprising now?
I was really excited about Grace, Soul, and Mother Wit. And when people ask me, what does that title mean? I asked them to think about sitting down at the table and communing with people as an act of love. And when you sit down to a table, you usually say grace. And it is the grace of the event that I really wanted to start with. And the soul is just my heart and my community and my culture that I poured into this book. And Mother Wit is something that you either are born with or you learn it the hard way, but it's basically common sense. So there are a lot of little tips and common sense things throughout the book as well. So thence the title is Grace, Soul, and Mother Wit.
The reflection of you, the reason I wanted you on Inspired with Patrick L. Riley, you are very much a Renaissance woman. You have sort of walked through doors to express yourself in a multitude of creative ways.
He gave me a lot of different talents, and I want to use them all up.
Well, we have enjoyed watching each and every one of them. I want to show you something, and then we'll talk about it. Joseph.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Daphne Maxwell. We're here in Hollywood, the city of the stars, awaiting the arrival of solo recording artist, The Whispers. The Whispers are about to begin their 1981 tour throughout the United States. As you know, their last album was certified platinum. And here they are now. Maybe we can get... Hi. How are you? How's it feel being platinum?
It feels great.
And ready for gold on this album?
I'm like, listen, ready. Stay ready. Okay?
Yeah. How are you?
Oh, great. Just fine. How you doing?
Just fine. Ready for gold on...
Yes. Okay. Okay.
My guys.
Your guys.
And you notice that suit that I was wearing? I made that suit because I made all the clothes that I wore in the 80s.
The multi-layered, the multi-talented, the beautiful, the history-making, the herstory-making, Daphne Maxwell Reed. Thank you for coming on Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. We love you. If a movie was made of your life, what genre would it be?
It would be a biopic.
Who would play you, or would you play yourself?
I don't know. Somebody fabulous, hopefully.
Absolutely, absolutely. Our second guest inspires me because he is the author of three collections of poetry. 2019's The Tradition, finalist for the 2019 National Book Award and the winner of the 2020 Pulitzer Prize for Poetry. Please welcome my people to Inspired with Patrick L. Riley, Jericho Brown. Hello, my brother.
Hi, hey, brother. How you doing? I'm Jericho Brown. I'm Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. How you doing? It's good to see you.
So good to see you. Many things changed, I think, really last March, maybe February. I know you were on the road and got called home. Many of us have gone through phases inside this last year. What has the pivot looked like for you? What have you been able to continue to do? And what have you had to do differently as a a lecturing poet, a traveling poet?
Most of what we did moved to Zoom. And I recently had a poem come out that commemorates the inauguration in the New York Times.
Beautiful. The optics of Amanda's poetry at the inauguration as a poet, did that mean something to you, the young voice, young Black voice, young inclusive voice?
I was so glad that a poet was included. I mean, first of all, just to have a poet at the inauguration at all, that doesn't have to happen. So seeing that happen, and I thought, as it relates to the arts performers, they were all great, but it's really amazing that Amanda Gorman, if we really just want to rank performances that day, she stood out.
Let's talk about inspiration. You know, a big part of why I even wrote my book, That's What Friends Are For, and the Women Who Inspired Me, is because inspiration unpacked is a little bit of what keeps me going. Can you talk about where the inspiration lived for you as a child?
I loved music that was born way before, who knows why, but I loved Motown, I loved the Temptations, I loved Stevie Wonder. I loved thinking about the mythologies of Motown. And of course, like you, I am the biggest Diana Ross fan. I fell in love with Diana Ross. And I would say even now, she remains a huge influence for me as a person who, just because she's a person who really worked toward being herself. I want to take all of the inspiration around me from so many poets, Gwendolyn Brooks, Natasha Trethewey, Rita Dove, Tracy K. Smith, so many poets that come before me, Essex Hemphill, Asada Saint, Marlon T. Riggs. And I want to take all of those influences and I want to use me. They have to come through that which is Jericho Brown to be the poems that I make now. So that's been really important to me.
For proof we existed before too late. Sped the video to see blossoms brought in seconds. Colors you expect in poems where the world ends. Everything cut down. John Crawford, Eric Garner, Mike Brown.
Well, I love the Diana parallel, the way that you unpack her arc in life to your own arc in life. I know you weren't christened Jericho Brown. Could you talk about, on some level, maybe, what distinguishes the name you were given to the name that you gave yourself, kind of a la Miss Ross?
I was born Nelson Demery III. And Nelson Demery wasn't so bad, but that third part used to get on my nerves. And so I changed my name because I wanted a name that was original and unique to me, right? I wanted a name that was a name that we knew went on those poems.
I love that. And through the years, through many published works, Jericho Brown is the 2020 winner of the Pulitzer Prize in poetry. Now, I can't let you leave me without us playing a couple of clips. Fair usage. I've Googled you on this performance. Talk about it. The specialness of that performance.
This is when I knew that it was over for me. When that earring falls, and it literally in the choreography, she catches the earring and keeps going as if nothing has happened. That's a superstar.
From the heavens and back to the heavens. Well, you know, Diana is supreme and so is Jericho Brown. If a movie was made of your life, what genre would it be?
Oh, it would just be a drama. But you know, I know who would play me too. Obviously, somebody, one of the Wayans descendants would probably end up playing me.
Thanks to our guests, Erica Cobb, Daphne Maxwell Reed, and Jericho Brown. Weren't they inspiring? Now, folks, please see Who Inspires Dr. Daniel Black.
Wow, this is so much fun. The most inspiring person in my life would undoubtedly be my great-grandmother. She was born in 1894, and she absolutely loved knowledge. She had been a school teacher. She had only gone to the eighth grade, but she loved knowledge. She loved reading. She was an old woman by the time I was born, but she instilled in me a love for literature. She would have me to read to her. When her sight went bad, she would close her eyes and ask me to read things from the Reader's Digest or from the Bible. And she would ask me to dramatize it, to act it out, so that she could literally feel and hear and taste the words. In so many ways, she was preparing me to be a writer and probably didn't even know it. But she also liked me. I was a very different child in the rural Black South as a little boy. And she loved me, but she liked me. She prepared the way for me. My great-grandmother saved me. She never asked me to be anything other than what I was. And in fact, she dared me to change. And she made all the difference. She was salvific for me. Wow, my great-grandmother, Stella Virginia Swinton.
Thanks again for joining our inspiring conversation. And please keep following the civically re-engaged women wherever they are. And these boss women are everywhere. Shout out to CEO and President Sharon Nelson, our Inspired with Patrick L. Riley executive producer. See you next time on Inspired with Patrick L. Riley. The L is for love.